Late last year, Apple took their laptop game to the next level with the M1 MacBook Air and the M1 MacBook Pro. Now, while most clamored for that new Apple Silicon hardware, I personally sat back and waited to avoid some of the growing pains with the new hardware. Well, I finally decided to take the leap of faith, and I went ahead and purchased an M1 MacBook Air from the certified refurbished section of the Apple website. In today's video, we're gonna touch bases on my initial impressions after about a week of heavy usage, and we're gonna find out how I feel about this laptop so far. Sit back, relax, and enjoy the video. Welcome to Ike's Tech Talk. If this is your first time stopping by the channel, thank you so much for being here. While you're here, don't forget to hit that like and subscribe button down below. And with that being said, let's get started. So first we're gonna go ahead and talk about the design of the M1 MacBook Air. So most of the changes are on the inside versus being on the outside. Between the 2019 MacBook Air and then the 2020 MacBook Air. So as far as the design, you're gonna get a lot of the same. Probably the biggest hardware change with the new M1 MacBook Air is, like I said, on the inside. And that's pretty much the keyboard, because the keyboard, I'll give you guys a spoiler, is 110% better than it's ever been on any previous MacBook. But before we get inside, I want to talk a little bit about my particular unit. Now, what I mean when I say that is this unit was from the Apple certified refurbished section. So now what that entails, I honestly could not tell you. You'd have to go on their website and take a look. I'll leave a link there in the description so you guys can go ahead and take a look and see exactly what that means. Now, I'm gonna preface this by saying, look, if Apple boxed this unit up in a brand new MacBook Air package, like with the brand new box, with the picture of the system on the front, all of that fancy stuff, I literally would not be able to tell you guys that this is certified refurbished. So we'll go ahead and take just a tour around the machine. Obviously here you can see no damage to it whatsoever. There's no cracks, there's no dents. Even on the inside, when we get to that, I'll show you guys, it's 100% perfect. Like I said, I don't know why people are sleeping so hard when it comes to the certified refurbished section of the Apple website. I literally got this machine hundreds of dollars off what I would have normally paid for it brand new. So if you are one of those people sleeping, I'm gonna need you to go ahead and wake up and take a look. So let's go ahead with that being said and get on the inside. So here on the inside, like I said, the biggest hardware change is going to be with this keyboard. Now Apple did update the keyboard from the last generation. The last generation had the butterfly key switches. Now let me be the first person to tell you that these butterfly key switches, I can't even begin to tell you how frustrating they were. On every last generation MacBook in general, not just MacBook Air or MacBook Pro, but MacBook in general, I had issues. I had issues with the sticky keys where the keycaps would get stuck. You'd have to pop off the keycaps, try to clean them, all of that. And I also had the double letter typing issue where you'd hit a key. In my case, it was always the L key. You'd hit a key, it would double type that letter. So I'd literally have to hit L and hit backspace in order to get one single L. And I had to type like that for like 2 months while they waited for parts to come in so they could fix my machine. And lo and behold, within a month or two, I was back at the Apple store trying to get a replacement, trying to get it fixed or whatever the case may be. So to say that the last generation keyboard was a disaster, it is a complete and utter understatement. I'm happy to report that this one is significantly better in key travel and in quality. Like I said, I use these keys even plugged into an external monitor. I still use my MacBook open. I've used these keys, like I said, over the past week, and they have been fantastic. If I had to kind of give you guys an idea of what they feel like, think of a hybrid between the 2015 MacBook Pro and the butterfly switches. It feels somewhat in between that. You still get a ton of key travel. You can probably hear that. But at the same time, these are actually wider keycaps than the 2015 model. So it feels a little bit more easier to type on this machine. Like I said, I felt my typing not just get faster, but more accurate. Because it's not always about speed, it's about accuracy. So like I said, I feel super accurate, super fast typing on this particular keyboard. You also still get Touch ID, which like I said, is a staple now. You don't get the touch bar here on the Air line. You do get that on the Pro line. I know some people love it, some people hate it. if you're in the camp that you love it, obviously you need to look at the Pro. The touch pad on the Air is a little bit smaller than the one on the Pro. So if you want the bigger touch pad, which like I said, I've been using this one, and in all honesty, it still feels just as clicky. It still feels great when it comes to the gestures. I honestly haven't noticed too much of a difference, to be honest with you. Like I said, it is just a little bit smaller. So if you want the biggest touchpad, then obviously, you know, go with the Pro. That's gonna be the one for you. If I had to give areas of improvement, so areas of improvement when it comes to the design of the MacBook, and this is not gonna just go for the MacBook Air. This is gonna go for the entire MacBook lineup in general. So one, this top bezel here, I'm gonna say it's about time for that to shrink, at least to come and to come in line with the ones here on the side. Now, I know people are gonna say, hey, it's because the camera's here, which is true, the camera is there. But at the same time, we're getting this thick bezel and we still have this same 720p camera. I'm not giving Apple a pass for that anymore. We need an upgraded camera. Now, even if the camera was 1080p, that would be perfectly fine. Now, I know people are gonna be like, oh, well, you know, it's super, super thin. They can only fit, you know, a 720p camera in there or whatever the case may be. You're probably 100% right. Technologically, it's probably hard to put a higher resolution camera in there. But at the end of the day, you have other manufacturers finding innovative ways to put their cameras, you know, inside of their machines. Huawei, for example, has a great implementation when it comes to their selfie camera on their laptops. It's in one of the keycaps. So you open up the keycap when you need the selfie camera, and then when you don't need it, you close it. That's awesome for security. So Apple, you know, super security focused, super security conscious, its customers are, that's gonna be fantastic. Go ahead and just put it in the keycap. That way you can give a bezel-less display up here. Like I said, that would be probably the only two areas that I would say need to be improved on, say, the next generation, which we already have rumors on. I personally don't like the white bezels. Hopefully there's an option with black bezels or something like that. But if the new iMacs are anything to go off of, there probably won't. But I'm not a fan of the white bezels. But like I said, the two key areas, 720p cam, let's get that updated. And then that top bezel, let's just bring that in line with the other ones. Just like I said, that way it can look good symmetrically. That's about it for the design though. Like I said, besides those two issues, fantastic look, fantastic build quality, no flex whatsoever when it comes to the machine. Golden standard, you know, is what Apple has set with these MacBook, you know, with these MacBook laptops. Now we're gonna go ahead and get into performance. So as far as performance, to say that this thing is nothing short of a beast is a complete and utter understatement and a disservice. This machine has been, to this day, the fastest laptop I have ever used. Now, when I'm talking speed, I'm not just talking Geekbench scores. I'm not just talking, you know, synthetic benchmarks. I'm not just talking anything like that. I'm talking just overall performance. Something can be fast, but you not be able to quantify that speed in day-to-day performance. This MacBook Air feels faster than previous gen MacBooks. It's something that I can't quite put my finger on. I don't know if they just made macOS smoother for these particular units, but everything just seems to run faster, whether it's opening applications, whether it's booting the machine up, whether it's waking the system from sleep. Hell, I'll even go ahead and wake the machine up from sleep right now while we're talking so you guys can kind of get an idea of what I'm talking about. Now, keep in mind, my watch, as you can see right there, did go ahead and open it up. But like I said, even if I was to just close it here and then immediately go ahead and just reopen it, you can already see, even without it unlocking via my watch, how fast it wakes up from sleep. Everything about this machine just screams speed. Just bear in mind, just to give you guys a little bit of background as far as my usage, I work for an IT firm by day. And with the IT firm that I work for, we have to use a specific program that's only made for Windows. Now, normally this would be some type of issue or whatever the case may be. What I personally do is run a piece of software called Parallels. I have that right here, Parallels Desktop. And what it does is it allows me to essentially boot into Windows. I can actually have Windows on my external screen up top and have macOS on my normal laptop screen here, or vice versa, however I see fit. So just keep in mind, I have Parallels open, which if you know anything about VM software, you know it's very, very intensive. It pretty much fueled my whole reasoning for getting the 16 gigabyte RAM model instead of just getting the bare minimum 8. But if, like I said, if you know anything about virtual machines, they're super, super resource hungry, resource intensive. Now, I'm not just running that. I'm running Parallels Desktop. I'm running Microsoft Teams. I'm running a couple cheat sheets that I have stored in my notes. I'm also running like 4 or 5 tabs in Safari. I have the Twitter app running. I have mail being pulled down and I have messages pulled up so I can keep in contact with all of my contacts and with all my text messages. Well, even with this type of usage, and I'll go ahead and flash a screenshot that I took of my activity monitor while I was running essentially the limit of what I'd be doing with this machine, I'm still averaging about 3 to 4 gigabytes of RAM left, idle, which means it's just leaving that memory for macOS to just run smooth. This machine has been a dream to work on, from doing heavy tasks like Parallels with virtual machines to doing video editing in iMovie. It has literally cut through everything like butter. It has been fantastic. I honestly can't find one con to talk about when we're talking about performance. Everything with this machine has been fantastic and it's been a dream. Now, when it comes to battery life, this machine has been a champ as well. I hate to sound like an Apple sheep talking about this machine, but Apple really knocked it out of the park with this one. That M1 chip that's inside this machine allows it to have the battery efficiency of something I've never seen in any laptop available on the market. Even after a 3.5 to 4 hour session, I'm literally only seeing roughly a 10 to maybe 12% battery drain. Whereas the same exact editing session on my previous 2017 MacBook Pro would have been 20 to 25%. And again, that was a MacBook Pro. This is a MacBook Air. Also to touch on as well while we're talking about the battery is the machine doesn't get hot at all. I haven't had any issues with it overheating. Again, it doesn't have a heat sink or a fan in it, so it's extremely silent, extremely quiet, where the fans on my last generation MacBook Pro literally would sound like a jet takeoff within 5 or 10 minutes of my particular usage. I actually had to download software to kind of turn down the fan sound of my previous gen MacBook Pro. That's how loud they got. Whereas, like I said, this one obviously is quiet as a mouse and stays as cool as a cucumber under even my most heavy of loads. So to say, like I said, that the battery life is great is literally me just not doing the machine justice. If battery life was an area of concern for this machine, I would say that's something you're never gonna have to worry about. I would feel comfortable taking this machine on, say, charge it to 100% on a Friday night, take it out of town with me on a flight, do some editing while on the plane, have it with me day to day, and come home on a Sunday and still have battery life remaining. Now, like I said, I can't wait till we're able to travel a little bit more with the pandemic, you know, still going on or whatever the case may be. But like I said, I have no reserves in saying that this machine will literally last you an entire weekend with medium, I would say with light to medium usage. So that's gonna do it for my first week with the M1 MacBook Air. Let me know down in the comments below if you have an M1 Mac, and if you do, what's your experience been like? Thank you so much again for watching. Have a great day. Stay safe, guys.